To every life, there must be a cause of death. Man's actions, inactions, or be it the random roulette of fate, decides our date of departure. But why would humans who know the cause and effects of chemicals on their body purposely and repeatedly ingest them, even when the results of their actions have significantly reduced their quality of life? Cigarette packaging warns, and I quote, "Smoking can cause a slow and painful death." Marijuana has been outlawed for nearly 100 years, but recent data has revealed that the mixture of these two substances is a cocktail of slow poison, which contributes to chronic obstructive pulmonary disease and related heart failure. Yet, ganja smokers who mix ignore the warning signs until it is too late, until they are gasping for life. Why do people start smoking, and why is it so hard to stop? Most smokers started the habit when they were teens. Those who have friends or parents who smoke are more likely to start smoking than those who don't. Some teens say they just wanted to try, or they thought it was cool to smoke. According to the 2014 United States Surgeon General's report, nearly 9 out of 10 adult smokers started before age 18, and nearly all started by age 26. The report estimates that about 3 out of 4 high school smokers will become adult smokers. It also noted that of every 3 young smokers, only one will quit, and one of those remaining smokers will die from tobacco-related causes. Most of these young people never considered the long-term health consequences associated with smoking tobacco when they started smoking, causing many to continue smoking well into adulthood, often with deadly consequences. Over the past 10 years, surveys have shown a drop in the number of cigarette smokers while recording an incremental rise in marijuana use. Perhaps it stems from the greater availability of the product, or the lax punishment for possession of a ganja spliff, or maybe the very pronounced medical purposes are being touted and embraced. Whatever it is, a greater and more diverse section of the population is embracing marijuana, the effect of which is an influx of patients into hospitals exhibiting signs of chronic obstructive pulmonary disease.
It's a disease where there is difficulty in taking air into your lungs and in expelling air from your lungs. So usually people tend to present with shortness of breath, cough, usually productive cough. Initially it may be dry, but productive.
It's actually 3 diseases that manifest in a particular way and have a root cause which is similar. There's chronic bronchitis, which is chronic inflammation of the airways, the larger airways, I should say. And then there's emphysema, which is the destruction of lung tissue. And then there's small airway disease or bronchiolitis, which often goes along with the chronic bronchitis. So most people with COPD tend to have a mixture of these 3 pathological manifestations of COPD.
It is not reversible, and the most common cause for COPD is the use of tobacco. In the past 10 years or so at Victoria Hospital, I work in the emergency department at Victoria Hospital, the doctors on the ward, the internal medicine doctors, brought to our attention, and we were actually seeing it already in the ER, the number of young patients who were presenting with very advanced COPD. Was very concerning. And we started to look at why these mostly young men were presenting in their, I'm talking about early 30s and 40s, very young, and even in their 20s as well, presenting with difficulty breathing.
Coal making is one. Tobacco smoking is another. Cannabis smoking is another. And mixing cannabis and tobacco is the fourth. What we have found actually in those is that the cannabis smoking by itself, although it has COPD, It does not seem to have the progression to end-stage lung disease that we're seeing in the other types of smoking. Tobacco by itself tends to produce chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, end-stage lung disease, after about, say about 40 or 50 pack years. And so you tend to get men in their 70s, or people, I should say, men and women in their 70s, that who have been smoking for essentially their lifetime, from their early 20s or so, they tend to be coming down at that time. Unfortunately, if you're mixing cannabis and tobacco, and by the way, it's not just, the myth is often it's just a black tobacco. It is, the mixing of cannabis is with cigarette tobacco as well as black tobacco. Both of them are detrimental. In addition, people who tend to smoke a joint, you tend to inhale quite deeply and you tend to hold. So you tend to pull the smoke with all its toxins deep into the lung tissue, to the most vulnerable areas, the bronchioles and the alveoli, the respiratory ducts, deep down inside there. And these are very thin-walled structures, and they're very easily damaged.
As I walked down the stairs in Palme Sufre, my subject's shoulders rose and dropped with every step. His chest relayed a paragraph without punctuation, and his jovial demeanor was halted after only 40 seconds of walking. So we allowed him to catch his breath long enough to take us from his first smoke to a life plagued with pulmonary obstruction.
I first started smoking weed at the age of 15, 16, at a young age.
Why?
Because I wanted just to catch the high. I hear people talking about marijuana, just give you a high. So I wanted to catch the high. So I entered the game. So you see how difficult it is in the morning. But sometimes in the morning when I bathe, I feel a little better. So I could walk right through there without stopping.
In those early days, did you used to mix your marijuana with tobacco?
With tobacco. I never smoked straight marijuana. Always mix with tobacco. Always.
Why?
Because I just like the hard juke it is to give. Marijuana, tobacco is something that's very strong. So when you smoke plain marijuana, it makes you cough. But with tobacco, it's a mellow high. You don't cough. It passed freely. It's sweet. It was sweet.
And in those early days, did you ever hear of the dangers of smoking marijuana mixed with tobacco?
No. If I knew, I would not.
What were the first signs of trouble for you?
The first sign of trouble for me, when I started walking, I started to wheeze a little. But I never expected that was a trace of COPD. I always used to think, well, it's like an asthma, because at the tender age, I had a trace of an asthma.
What changes did you make post your diagnosis?
No changing, continue smoking.
Mervyn Joseph.
Yes.
The doctor sits with you and explains to you you have chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. It's triggered by your smoking. Exalve?
Continue smoking. Because smoke is something that was very sweet. Smoke, to me, was very sweet. It's not to me alone, everybody that's smoking, smoke is sweet because they cannot leave it. It's very addictive. They can't leave it, but I guess when they reach my stage.
What's the difference in the two of them?
I help you breathe, open the lungs. Two deadly drugs are that way. Bicotang and Ventolin. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Every time you smoked post your diagnosis, did you think about the impact on your body?
When I smoke, I don't think about that. It's after I finish smoking that I believe me now, I just think, well, I'm sick a kind of way. Why should I smoke? But the moment I get smoke again, I will smoke.
For how many years after your diagnosis did you smoke?
Roughly 10.
And during these 10 years, were you ever hospitalized for COPD?
Many times. I even escaped hospital once to one smoke.
What do you mean?
I was on guard. I was in the hospital, in Sufra Hospital, on a watch. It was around 2 o'clock in the morning. I had money in my pocket. I decided, well, to escape from the hospital to go and smoke. Put off the tank and escape and went and smoke. I used to be smoking, buy my stuff, lie down certain place, smoke, take leaf, pass in my hand, spoil my mouth everywhere, so I could get away with the smell and then call the ambulance after. Tomato, cucumber, bell pepper. That's a sweet life. That's a very sweet life, man.
Moving, some would say that you brought this illness on yourself. You did not take care of yourself. The problem was exacerbated, and now you are here. Who is to blame?
I blame myself. 100%. Because I saw the sign and I continued smoking.
Describe for us how COPD makes you feel.
Well, tired, wheeziness, when you walk too much, not even walk too much, so much short distance, you have to stop and catch your breath. Sometimes you have to even lie down to catch your breath.
What do you mean by a short distance? What's a short distance for you?
About 5 feet, 6 feet.
Was there ever a hospital visit that you thought that you were close to death?
Many times. I've been to St. Jude once, not once, many times, but the last visit I went to St. Jude was 2017. That was in February 7th, and I spent roughly a month there, and it was very bad. No doctors could do nothing. The only thing they could do is discharge me and send me home to make soap tomorrow.
Pumpkin.
P-U-M-P. P-U-M-P. K-I-N-G. Oh, it wasn't affecting the erection, but the daggering, it wasn't too good. It's not too good. Sometimes you do last for, not last like you ejaculate, but the knocking, you do last 5 minutes knocking.
30 seconds. Come on, 30 seconds.
About more than that sometimes, if you're a strong man like me. Probably some other patients might last 30 seconds or 20 seconds, but sometimes, you see, you go on a cool level. Sometimes I have sex with oxygen in my nose sometimes, but...
Mama!
God, that tough, not me, huh?
What is the reception from most people when you try to explain to them what COPD is and why it is so important to stop mixing tobacco and marijuana?
I don't get good response. Bad response, because I was so at time. When people used to talk about, tell me, well, stop the smoking because I'm sick already, and I used to be vexed for that because I like my smoke. So that's the same happening to them now. Not because you're sick, you tell me stop smoking, as I will stop when I want.
Mervyn Joseph, what does the future hold for you?
Only God knows right now. Right now, in my condition, I leave everything in God's hands.
After watching Mervyn's struggles, I pondered on one question. Why would someone be fully aware of the detrimental effects of smoking on their severely damaged lungs and still continue the practice? Turns out, this weakness lies within us all. A big reason has to do with the brain's chemicals. Certain things like chocolate trigger the release of natural chemicals in the brain that make us feel good. Naturally, we feel an urge to keep doing those things, but some things are harder to resist than others. Tobacco contains a very powerful addictive drug called nicotine. When nicotine reaches the brain, it fits perfectly in a receptor that releases those feel-good chemicals. Tobacco provides the brain with very high amounts of nicotine. As a result, the brain creates even more nicotine receptors, all of them wanting to be fed with more nicotine. Those urges can be very hard to resist. When you stop using tobacco, the body experiences symptoms of withdrawal. To resist these symptoms can be particularly difficult, as smokers get nicotine to the brain in less than 10 seconds. But over time, If you don't use tobacco, the urges gradually weaken and the nicotine receptors begin disappearing, allowing people to enjoy the many benefits of being tobacco-free. When we return, we carry Bongo Barry up a steep hill. We chat with a Rasta about ganja, and we meet a wife still in mourning.
Of all health decisions are influenced by lab results. Delivery of accurate, reliable, and timely results has been our mandate for over 20 years. We are Laboratory Services and Consultations Limited, generating hundreds of lab tests each year while delivering quality, personalized, confidential service, one client at a time. With a reliable network of regional and international partners, all tests are conducted with patient care in mind. Laboratory Services and Consultations Limited, saving lives and caring for people. We focus on results so you can focus on what's important. Telephone 459-2200.
COPD has four stages. In stage one COPD, people may not realize that they have a problem yet. Many people continue with their daily activities with slight limitations to their breathing. Some people experience a cough and phlegm. During stage two of COPD, many people notice more coughing and mucus production. People tend to seek medical care for limitations in breathing and increased symptoms. Stage 3 or severe COPD has a large impact on people's quality of life. Lung function continues to decline and breathing becomes more difficult. Typically, COPD symptoms make it challenging to enjoy your favorite activities or to perform daily tasks. During this stage, many people feel more fatigue and have difficulty exercising. By end stage COPD, many people have trouble receiving enough oxygen. Low blood oxygen levels can lead to serious health conditions such as hypoxia, hypoxemia, or cyanosis and other problems. When low blood oxygen levels occur, oxygen therapy is a must.
COPD is becoming the third leading cause of death worldwide, and it's more common in lower middle income countries, because in the developed countries, before, many people used to smoke, but now they have realized the detrimental effects of smoking. They no longer, smoking is less than before.
You come into contact a lot with the smokers. From your research, what percentage of them are mixing marijuana and tobacco?
I would say 50% of them, which is a frightening statistic. Now, what I believe, I mean, I've been burning for 42 years, so I'm well acquainted with smoking ganja. And the actual boom, when you draw that herb with the tobacco, you get a kind of boom in your head. It's like an expansion. And I think these guys are chasing that feeling because it gives them a high that is sort of different than the ganja high. So what happens now, these same guys roll another joint because the feeling that they've been chasing diminishes fast and it goes away. So they roll another joint with more tobacco in it, and so they actually consume more. So apart from the tobacco itself causing the adverse effects on the lungs, they're smoking more of it. So it's a sort of double jeopardy.
Peter Bissett picked up a cigarette at age 7. He had his first draw of the herb at age 13 and has been mixing ever since.
It happened that his friends that influenced me to smoke marijuana and tobacco. You know, like they used to mix it and give it to taste it, you know? And it happened that I could not smoke marijuana without tobacco now. I'd rather have the tobacco before having the marijuana, because if I have the marijuana, I would stay the whole day with it, I would not smoke. Yeah, but if I would rather have the tobacco, I'll feel good because I know anytime I get the marijuana, I will smoke.
Describe smoking marijuana by itself versus smoking marijuana with tobacco. How does it taste?
Well, when I smoke marijuana by itself, it has caused me to cough a lot. But when I smoke it with tobacco, it will not cause me to cough.
Describe the changes in your body as you continued smoking.
When I smoke the marijuana, while you smoking the marijuana, about an hour, you're breathing good. But when the high is gone, and after about 2 to 3 hours, you will feel like your breathing getting, you know, I mean, you're getting tight, you know? And then after, then you'll go back to it. While you're taking it, you will feel like you're breathing a little better. But as the high's gone about an hour, you'll feel like more and more the chest coming more tight.
Did you ever have to be hospitalized because of that?
Oh, I was hospitalized so much times already. And let's say like, there were times I used to go to hospital mostly 3 or 4 times a week.
What?
Yeah. So then a whole week, every day.
During these times, were you still smoking?
Yeah.
Wait. You were being hospitalized nearly every day in a week.
Yeah.
You knew what was causing your trips to the hospital, correct?
Doctors didn't tell me that yet, but I myself was feeling it.
That it was the smoking?
Yeah.
And when you leave the hospital?
When I leave the hospital, I go home, I'll feel a little better, then I'll go back to it. And the next following day, I'll have to go and nebulize again. I told them certain time, it depends on what kind of work I'm doing. I smoke about 5 or 6 or certain time, about 10 pieces for the day.
10 joints for the day?
Yeah.
With tobacco?
Yeah.
Tell me about the worst incident, the worst hospitalization you've ever been through.
Oh, I spent about 3 days in ICU. I didn't know nothing. I was home. I feeling well. I going to pass out because I cannot breathe again. My breathing pipe was like, it was choking. So I called my wife. I told my wife, I'm dying. She thought it was a joke. When I feel like I was going to fall down, I rest my back on the wall and I slide down. And I slide down slowly, you know.
When you recovered
yeah.
from that incident,
yeah.
did you continue smoking?
I still continue.
Why?
I don't know, but certain time, like when I smoke, I used to feel myself, you know, different, like a little different, you know. Like I would not bother with anything. Nobody say you could come and quarrel and do and say anything. I would not take you on.
Have you ever been on oxygen at the hospital?
Oh yeah. A lot of times, I can't even recall.
At this moment, are you still a smoker?
No. No. I'm not smoking again. I don't even want to stay close to people that's smoking. And I hate cigarettes. I cannot take the smell of cigarette. When I told people, I cannot take the smell of cigarette, they'll be, you hypocrite. So much cigarette you used to smoke. And now you can't eat it. I told them, no, I cannot take the smell of it. But if I see somebody smoking there, I'm not coming there.
Describe when you're having one of those COPD attacks.
Let me tell you, when I have a COPD attack, certain time when I'm home, I just feeling like I shut in my breath and things I used to do, I cannot do it. You know, your body coming slow and you cannot do what you used to do. Because once it takes me about 3.5 hours to come from Bern and where they have the medical restaurant there to the hospital. About 3 hours. And I had to hold, you see them pine trees are there? When I hold one, I had to stay about almost 20 to 25 minutes to hold the other one. And the distance is about almost 4 to 5 feet away from each other. And I see it, well, I close to the hospital so and I will not make it.
Some would say that you brought this upon yourself and now you are a burden to taxpayers, you are a burden to the healthcare system, to your family, because you knew very well that every time you took a draw, you were drawing yourself closer to death. Now somebody else must be financially responsible for your medical demise. What would you say?
Now, at that time, I was ignorant. Is now I see it. Now. Because if I had the mind I have now, I would not even smoke a joint. Well, my advice to them is don't even start it. If you already taste it, just leave it. You know? Because if they want to see, just go to Victoria Hospital to see the amount of people that COPD and how they are living and how they're breathing, you know? They should go and take an example and see how it is, you know? That's what I would advise them.
Have you ever gotten a chance to speak with other young men who are currently smoking marijuana and tobacco? And what is the reception from them when you speak to them?
Well, a lot of them, like, they don't care. They don't care. I just tell them I was ignorant of it and I went through it. And I regret. Now, I will encourage you all, just don't start it.
What I like about the LTE plan is that the plans are cheaper and the coverage is wider.
What I like most about the new LTE plan is the free calls, the free calls, the free calls.
Come into any Luselec customer service office to request a new electricity connection. You will need an inspection certificate that's been approved by the Ministry of Infrastructure. A copy of the land register for the property on which the connection is to be made, valid picture ID with NIC number, and a security deposit for an estimated 2 months of consumption. If you are renting, we suggest a move-in authorization form as provided by our offices and a copy of your landlord's ID.
Say Rastafari, and the two first flashes are dreadlocks and marijuana. Culturally entrenched in the Rastafari movement since it began in the 1930s, marijuana, ganja or the herb is considered sacred and is often referred to as the weed of wisdom or the holy weed. Rastas refer to Revelations chapter 22 verse 2, the herb is the healing of the nations. Despite what many think, Rastas actually condemn the use of marijuana simply to get high. Instead, it is usually used within religious ceremonies in a highly ritualized manner in order to enhance feelings of unity and help generate visions of a spiritual and soothing nature.
There is no other love than Rastafari.
Rastafari has always been promoting the cannabis as the healing of the nation, not cannabis and tobacco. So the people who want to mix their tobacco with cannabis I personally will tell them it is not a good practice. But some people, again, cultural ties, cultural, you know, affiliations and so on, you know, they tell you, well, boy, some man even tell you, well, boy, that the tobacco they smoke is, they themselves grow it, so it is not contaminated.
But tobacco is tobacco,
tobacco is tobacco. Exactly.
Whether it be Fanto, black tobacco, otherwise cigarette tobacco, Benson and Hedges, it is tobacco.
Tobacco.
I want you to just take a deep breath in and out, eh?
Ras Bongo Barry has carried his crown of locks and has been a marijuana smoker since 1973. Now, at 54 years, he exhibits signs of stage 4 COPD.
Did you ever smoke cigarettes and marijuana?
Yeah, man, I smoked cigarette and marijuana. In fact, I used to smoke cigarette about 20 cigarettes a day, plus mix it with marijuana. Still smoke cigarette, tobacco, and marijuana.
Describe the high with black tobacco
and the natural weed.
Versus natural weed. How does it smoke?
The natural weed more mellow, keep you cool. And when you mix it with tobacco or Fanto, it give you a little boost. It keep you a little more rough. It's like cigar. That is why the guys like to smoke it. The boost it gives you. And you find, if you smoke a joint this morning, the whole day you mightn't smoke no more weed, you know. But when you mix it, a little later you'll want another joint. And a little later you want another joint. Like it's the boost up you want.
In your early days, did anybody ever caution you about mixing weed with tobacco?
No. I will caution you about that. And
Jahai, none of the older guys?
Nah. I will tell you, mix your weed. And if I'd come by your home and you don't smoke weed, I don't stay there. I start giving you names. You know? Because I feel, well, what I'm doing is the right thing.
Put it.
Okay.
You didn't have the tank, man.
No, it's okay.
It working?
Yeah, it's all over.
Without anybody telling me anything, I stopped smoking. I went to Martinique, and then I had a cold. And I say, I'll give the smoking a chance because I seen the coal not finishing. But when I come back St. Lucia, I meet with a girl, and every time she come by me, she bring in weed, rum, for us to have some fun. So I rejoin the smoking.
About how many joints would you smoke a day?
Man. Over 8 joints. I'll get up in the morning early, 5 o'clock, and pull my first joint.
Before your cup of tea?
Yeah. And then I'll go to the toilet with another joint. When I come back while making my tea, I have another joint. Anybody that know Bongo Bar will tell you that. Before I drink my tea, I'll smoke half a joint and put the rest there. But when I finish, drink the tea to continue. Then I go and bathe. From bathing, I have a joint smoking. Then on my way to work, I'll have a joint smoking. When I reach on the work, whole day smoke, I smoking. Whole day. So I was a chronic smoker, man.
Was it because you were addicted to the tobacco, or was it because you constantly wanted to be high?
Constantly want to be high. Yeah, that is one of the main things. Constantly want to be high.
Want AC?
Yeah. At the time, describe the changes in your body, how you were feeling, what was going on.
All right. I start coughing nonstop. My throat started coming dry. I started having inflammation my body start burning me. My lips start coming dry. You see? When I walk, I start losing air. I ain't tired, but the air in my body finishing. So I have to stop and like build back air for me to continue. By the time I tell you that I had buried 25 virgin already with that same COPD, so I start digging to see what is the COPD now.
Wait. How many are your friends?
25 virgin, both men and women.
Die from what?
From COPD, right here. You see?
At that time, were you still smoking?
Still smoking. I go into the funeral and I smoke at the funeral.
Oh, wow, that ain't true.
Because let me tell you, it only have about 2.5 years I stopped smoking. Now I've been fair to you, I'm telling you the truth.
You know what it's doing to your body. Why would you keep doing it? You see your brethren's dying from it. Why would you keep doing it?
Yeah, just have about 2.5 years I stopped smoking.
Hello.
Okay. Have you ever had a COPD attack at home?
Plenty time, man. Man, when you have that, you peeing on you, you shitting on you. Right here, I do that this week already. You peeing on you, you shitting on you. The only thing I do here is vomit. But the thing with it, you must know it. You must know it to control it.
How do you control it?
You have to move slow. Everything about that is very, very slow. You see, when you come here, I had to go and rest. Take your time, everything you're doing.
How about when you drive somewhere and there's smoke, somebody's burning bush or that sort
of thing? Oh man, I just want to look at them people and kill them. Right now, if you smoke cigarette anywhere outside there, I'll just tell you somebody's smoking.
The irony of life, huh? The irony of life.
Right now, I hate a man that's smoking.
Are you on home oxygen?
Yeah, I have one home. I just sleep with it. I have a couple of days, I have 3 days. It must be asking for me.
Ready?
This is not a cheap disease.
3,465 dollars every 3 weeks for 2.5 weeks.
But some would say that you brought this illness on yourself. You designed this, and even when you realize that this was becoming a problem, you continue, so you should deal with it. What do you say?
Well, my family don't look at it so. We just know, well, Barry smoke and he gets sick.
Some of your Rastafari brethren will be watching this and say, who's up, say, Maji, he said, Vale. They pee kill, tell, nothing on Marona. It's about him and we went. My grandmother died 105 years.
You see, when the man come by me, the man saying cool, and they moving, cause I knew they know I taught them. They have men that come and see me and then throw their weed and stop smoking one time, change their life. And they have men that will just not stop.
What do you think is a primary cause for your COPD?
I had a headache, man. You like what you like and you have a chance to do what is right.
So you ready?
Yeah.
You get it?
Mm-hmm. Any regrets?
Me? All what I'm telling you, there is regrets. Everything I've talked about, there is regrets. Russ, if I had known that would happen, I would never smoke. Never. Now, my advice to them man out there, stay away from man that's smoking.
What does the future hold for you, sir?
The future? Most times I just ask the doctors if I'm on death row.
What do you do for a living now?
Take care of my breath.
Do I prepare my documents and things?
Mm-hmm.
And you're right.
That's all I can do.
When we return, one man smokes himself to his grave, and will decriminalizing the herb result in more people gasping for life?
I watched him on the bed, knowing a man who has worked his entire life can't afford the cost of his surgery or medication. Mom and I must sell barbecue tickets to help save his life. For less than $4 a day, the cost of a packet of gum, my dad could have been airlifted to get treatment. Some adults can be so insensitive with their lack of foresight. Now, Mom and I either have to watch him wither away or sell a whole lot more barbecue. Why? Because one person didn't care enough to plan.
GTM Medical Insurance. Less than $4 a day for the greatest peace of mind anyone could ask for. Call us today, 458-6300.
I can stream 2 hours of local content for free every day.
I'm from Mikud, I'm a digital customer for over 9 years and I'll never switch.
Of all health decisions are influenced by lab results. Delivery of accurate, reliable, and timely results has been our mandate for over 20 years. We are Laboratory Services and Consultations Limited, generating hundreds of lab tests each year while delivering quality, personalized, confidential service, one client at a time. With a reliable network of regional and international partners, all tests are conducted with patient care in mind. Laboratory Services and Consultations Limited, saving lives and caring for people. We focus on results so you can focus on what's important. Telephone 459-2200.
The Pan-American Health Organization indicates that chronic obstructive pulmonary disease is a leading cause of morbidity and mortality in the Americas, representing an important public health challenge that is both preventable and treatable. The cost of treating COPD is debilitating, with most of the expense being absorbed by the Victoria Hospital and taxpayers.
So the Ministry of Health, realizing that it was a problem and we discussed with them, they have an initiative to supply people with an oxygen concentrator on a rental basis. Because if you use a tank, the tank runs out of oxygen very quickly. A concentrator, you plug it into the wall and it concentrates oxygen from the in environment. So they were able to come up with that initiative to help so that we would be able to discharge people at a much earlier date.
Most of the patients towards the latter stages of COPD develop a disease called corpopulmonale, which is right-sided heart failure. Once they develop that disease, they have an oxygen requirement. So simply to do the most basic things, most basic activities of daily living, they must have oxygen on to move from their bed to a commode, from a bed to their sink to brush their teeth, you know, to make a cup of tea. They require oxygen because the heart has failed now. Because the lungs are so damaged, it impacts the functioning of the heart and the heart fails. And so now you have a heart failure problem and you have a lung problem. And oxygen is extremely expensive. So the majority of these patients cannot afford oxygen at home and therefore have to come in. And sometimes they sleep in our asthma bay in the emergency room in a chair, sometimes 4 to 5 days straight. It robs them of those creature comforts that what you don't think about, sitting here just breathing in and out. Don't give it a second thought. Every breath for them is an effort. They fall asleep and they jump from their seat because they suddenly realize that they need oxygen and their body wakes them up. And you watch them, it's really a painstaking thing for those patients to breathe.
In life, he was a professional videographer, best known for filming funerals. He spent his last 24 years in the company of this woman. She watched as chronic obstructive pulmonary disease took him from 150 pounds to death.
Did he ever mix his joints with black tobacco?
Yes, at all times.
When did his health take a turn?
During different activities we did together, I recognized his breathing pattern was not the same as in 2007. But in 2010, that was the day when Christopher fell ill.
How did he deal with the diagnosis of COPD?
At first, I believe he was in denial. To him, you know what? Yeah, they say he's COPD, and they say he's a smoking. But in all fairness to him, he never smoked after 2010.
Describe a normal day for him with his breathing challenges. How far could he walk? What could he do or not do?
Okay, at the beginning, and Christopher just came from the hospital in 2010. It was a challenge. 2 steps would be a challenge for him. To go to the washroom would be a challenge.
Have you ever been there when he had one of his COPD attacks?
I've always been around during those times.
Describe a COPD attack.
Okay. I think I want to describe it as to how Christopher described it to me. He said to me, it's like something heavy sitting on your chest and you're trying to breathe, but you cannot.
Some would say that Christopher brought this on himself. Mm-hmm. What would you say?
I would say it's ignorance, because if Christopher knew what he knows before he died, he would not have smoked.
For you, how was that looking in from the outside? You look at him move from 150 pounds right down to dying. How was that for you from the outside?
Heartbreaking. I think the most challenging part for me was the fact that I could not do anything to make it better.
Do you think there were regrets for him?
I could speak based on what he said to me. He said what he regrets most is smoking. That's what Christopher said to me. Even the week before he died, Christopher told me if there's one thing he would not do, if he had to live again, is smoke.
It's my life, and I only got one life to live. I and I will leave it upright, regardless of the circumstances. My life is my life, and I only got one life to live. I and I will leave it upright, just the forehead got good messages to give. My life is worth more than gold. Can never be born or sold. It's a precious soldier, take control. My life is a blessing, I want the world to know.
I wish I could have visual images of people dying from COPD and say, look, you want that to happen to you?
If they want to see, just go to Victoria Hospital to see the amount of people that COPD and how they are living and how they're breathing.
The advice is quite clear. Don't mix tobacco of any type, cigarette tobacco or black tobacco or pipe tobacco. Do not mix tobacco with your cannabis. That includes your hash or your bush cannabis, your leafy cannabis. Do not mix it.
In conclusion, I should say, beware of smoking. Mixed with tobacco, within 30 years on average, even as young, as small, or as little as 20 years, they end with end-stage lung disease and die. And the problem with the disease is that before you die, the breath of life is, you are losing it. You find yourself short of breath all the time. You find yourself coughing. You find yourself not able to walk the hills. You find yourself not able to do the things that you should be able to do as a strong man or a strong woman. It robs you not only of your life, but of the quality of your life. That is the problem with the COPD and the corruption. So, brothers and sisters, do not corrupt the cannabis. Do not corrupt the herb.
Who'd go on and on, the fool has never been told. Who'd go on and on, the fool has never been told. Who'd go on and on, the fool has never been told. Who'd go on and on, the fool has never been told.
has never been told. Could go on and on, the fool has never been told. Could go on and on, the fool has never been told.